Hi, I'm Chuck Gibson. This is Taking Stock with Art Jarvis, a bi-weekly discussion of what is happening in the economy, the world of finance, and personal investment with Art Jarvis. Taking Stock with Art Jarvis is a presentation of Loveland Beacon in partnership with Jarvis Global Investments, LLC. Now here is Taking Stock. Art Jarvis, welcome back. Thank you for being here as we just dive right in to Taking Stock number 35. And then as we were just talking, Taking Stock episode 35, year two, number nine.
You got it. There you go. And, I'm happy to be here.
Oh, thank you. Well, you know, I always ask you, how are you?
Yeah. And the answer is?
Well, you said, let's see. You saw two different kinds of doctors.
Yeah.
And one said you're doing great, and the other one said you're falling apart.
Well,
So you're doing great.
But gradually falling apart, though. So that's the silver lining around it. Well, so, no, everything is fantastic.
The mental acuity for numbers is still sharp as a tack.
There we go.
You just proved that a minute
ago. That sticks around for a little while longer.
Well, I'm sure your clients are hoping so.
Yeah, it'd be good. Yeah, you're that or Caitlin and Austin. They take over. So.
Well, they're learning the ropes.
That's right.
You'll be learning them the ropes.
Exactly. Well, the nice thing is pretty much on a weekly basis, there's something new for them to learn. So that's and me and myself also. But it's never a dull moment anymore. That's for sure.
Well, and on this day, as we sit here on Tuesday, October the 1st, we mourn the loss of the Cincinnati legend, and frankly, a baseball legend, regardless of what anybody might say or argue. So Pete Rose left us yesterday at the age of 83.
Yeah.
And I'm only bringing this up because, you talk about learning and you're teaching. So I learned this Pete Rose story. I've heard a lot of Pete Rose stories. I got my own Pete Rose stories. But the Pete Rose story you shared with me, which I'm not going to, that's up to you to share it or not share. But that was a brand new one. I think that's pretty cool.
That's my brush with greatness, and we'll just leave it at that.
I think it's pretty cool.
I was 10 and 11 years old in 75 and 76. So the 2 years they won the World Series, and amazingly fond memories of that part of my life, it's good stuff. So, yeah, I hated to hear that, much like a lot of Cincinnatians, Pete Rose had layers, we'll say.
That's a good way to put it.
Yeah, so just like most of us, we all have layers, you think of baseball in Cincinnati, Pete Rose is most certainly, if he's not at the top, he's right next to it. So, hated to see that.
Well, a friend of mine from college days made a post on Facebook and said, and she is a native Cincinnatian, as is Pete. And her Facebook post, it could not have been better said than it's Jill Casagrande. And Jill said, he's a Cincinnati native. He's a true Cincinnatian. And she went through some of the things that are iconic about him as a Cincinnatian, as a Cincinnati Red, and a baseball player. And of course, at the end, she said, forget all that stuff. But at the end, she did say, and so for God's sakes, get him in the Hall of Fame.
Wow.
Too late. But
so someone made the comment today, and keep this going. But, someone made that if it's truly the Major League Baseball Hall of Fame, then it's not the Hall of Fame if Pete Rose isn't in it. And I agree. I agree with that 100%. So he wasn't perfect. None of us are perfect. But from the standpoint of being a baseball player, he belongs in there. So.
He is.
In case anyone listening and cares about my opinion. But
the argument's gone ad infinitum, forever and ever, amen. He was a Hall of Fame baseball player, regardless of anything else. Yep. And, that is enough. But, on this day, just as a side note, we do mourn the loss of a native Cincinnatian who is an absolute
Cincinnati baseball icon and frankly a Major League Baseball icon without question.
Without question.
Anyway, he signed a lot of autographs for money, so that's a whole different economic outlook.
Yeah. Yeah, he made a little bit of money on signing stuff.
What do you think about that investment? Let's take Pete Rose and autographs into taking stock. Okay. So, and not just Pete Rose, but what do you think about, you know, collectors and in terms, some people collect as an investment, some as a retirement kind of plan. It's like, I have this collection and potentially sell it. What do you say to that in the investment world?
We'll look at it from two different angles. So let's look at it from a supply and demand angle. There is not a shortage of supply of things signed by Pete Rose. So Pete Rose signed a lot of things. So, you know, the mere fact that there's, you know, obviously, you know, his memorabilia and things like that has gone up in value today, right? So, but there's a lot of it out there. So, you know, it's, you know, but, you know, you look at it. The interesting thing is like during the pandemic, you know, whenever we're all sitting at home trying to figure out what we're going to do with our lives, the trading card and memorabilia and all that kind of market, baseball cards and, you know, even like Pokemon cards and things like that, they shot up in value. I mean, that in a big way. It was a market that was kind of languishing, I guess is the way to put it. And, you know, somewhere in that, you know, post-pandemic period, the value of those things really went through the roof of all kinds of different collectibles. So it's interesting that we talk about supply and demand, because we got a whole bunch of supply and demand things going on here this week. So the sachet, but that's my comment on, you know, collectibles and things. I mean, a lot of financial planners and things like that use collectibles. My only problem with collectibles is, you know, it's fair market value. Well, but the definition of fair market value is what someone's willing to pay you for it. So
at the end of the day, I think, and that's the key lesson, as opposed to saying, hey, Art, tell us, collecting for an investment, good idea or bad idea, yay or nay, as opposed to answering a question like that. It's about, like, you know, what are the pitfalls? Well, at the end of the day, the one thing that holds true on any collectible is it is not worth anything except the price you sell it for on the day that you finally sell it, if you sell it.
You know, I enjoy cars, and, you know, you have Meekum or Barrett Jackson, the auto auctions, and, you know, you could have a 1967 split window Corvette. Ooh. And on Monday, it might be worth this amount. But on Tuesday, it might be worth a complete different amount. It's who's there, what are those people willing to pay for that? You know, it's not like, you know, it's not like a share of Procter & Gamble. If Procter & Gamble is trading today at $170 a share, if I go to buy and sell it, guess what? I'm probably going to get right around $170 a share, right?
Right.
So that's not how it works with the collectibles. That's not how it works with stamps and coins and cars and artwork and all. You know, it's... You know, you can say, I know it has increased in value, but it's very hard to make a statement that how much has it. Yeah. It's the same. People ask me about gold all the time, and, you know, the problem with gold is, you know, if you go buy gold, you're going to pay a commission, and then if you go to sell the gold, you're going to pay another commission. So, you know, if gold's trading at $2,700 an ounce, you know, it might cost you $2,800 an ounce, and then you go to sell it, you might only get $2,600 an ounce. Or, you know.
Ouch.
Yeah, so you're...
Well, that's the point.
Yeah, so I mean, that's a long... hopefully somewhere along the way I answered your question, but,
Well, you know, the idea is for listeners thinking about such things, you know, the advice isn't, yes, you should do it, no, you shouldn't. It's understand the risk reward of it, right. And you know, because it could just change in terms of collectibles.
Yep, exactly.
But something that we know more about, you do, and I keep learning more about each, you know, every other week when we do another edition of Taking Stock, another episode of Taking Stock. So the last taking stock 2 weeks ago, mm-hmm. and then we had the bonus edition, the bonus episode, the special edition, because the Feds made a decision and dropped the interest rates a half a point. Well, that's been 2 weeks ago, Art.
Yes, it has.
So what's happening today, and how do you feel like that impacted the marketplace?
Well, number one, I think we're in full trying to find ourselves mode, if that makes sense. I mean, I think, you know, we got at least what we were looking for. In my opinion, we got more than what we should have gotten, you know, with the half a point. But, you know, it's right now we're trying to figure out where to go. And it's interesting to me that, you know, so not only did we got a quarter, but we got a half a point. So that was a positive surprise. You know, by the time that day rolled around, it was about 60% probability that we would get half a point. So it wasn't a huge surprise, but it was still a surprise. So, and it was better than the other. You know, if they didn't do any cut, that would have been very negative. If they did the 25 basis point or the quarter point cut, that would have been considered a negative because it wouldn't have been good enough, right? So they did the half a point. They actually did a little more than what was expected. Whether it needed to be done or not, okay? The interesting thing to me going forward is very quickly we started having this conversation about, okay, we're going to lower it another half a point before the end of this year. And there's two more opportunities, one in November and one in December, for the Fed to lower rates if they want to. But, you know, I'm sitting there kind of, you know, again, I really didn't want a half a point to begin with, but no one called and asked me. But now we're talking about another half a point within the next 2 or 3 months. And I'm going, it's kind of like easy, okay? Calm down, people. That's, you know, we need to see what's going to happen. It takes time to see what's going to happen.
What happened immediately that maybe drove the notion that, hey, maybe we'll drop another half a point before the year's end? I mean, what do you think they were reading into that initial reaction to a half-point drop?
Well, I mean, first of all, it's coming out of the Fed's mouth, right?
Sure.
They're talking, you know, so when the Fed says to you, we may do another half a point between now and the end of 2024, and for me, I was stunned. Like, I couldn't believe that became the conversation, and it became the conversation that quickly. Mm-hmm. Now, in the last 2 weeks since that day, there's been a whole lot of people backing down from it.
You
know, there's other Fed governors that are on the committee and things like that. And even they're saying, we need to slow down here a little bit. You know, and there's some people, and I apologize, I can't remember her name, but she's one of the Fed governors, that she made the statement that she did not agree with the half a point cut to begin with, and most certainly doesn't agree with another half point cut anytime soon. So there is, I'm not going to use the word dissension, but there is some disagreement going on within the Fed of what.
Well,
is
it wasn't a unanimous,
course.
Let's do this.
Right.
They're all 100% behind.
Precisely.
So there's somebody asking questions.
Right.
And yeah. Which, you know, that's good news. Somebody's on that board of governors mm-hmm. saying, you know, let's think this through.
Right.
I mean, that's what, you know, as people who are going to be impacted by it, all we can hope for is the people that are guiding it are you know, asking questions, and they're not just, you know, jump. That's why, you know, and that's what my question, and I almost said, you know, maybe I could have better asked the question by saying, why did they start talking about potentially another cut? You know, again, what was driving them?
Yeah.
I know it was, you know, the Feds that were saying it, but that's not what was driving them. Why were they saying that?
Well, it's because we, as investors and traders and things like that, we want to know what is, you know, our game that we play here, and I'll call it a game, you know, is a game where you're playing 12 months in the future. Okay? So that's great that now I have the information of what just happened, but now I'm investing trying to figure out where I'm investing because I'm trying to take advantage of the next 12 to 18 months, right?
Yeah.
So that's you know, so they make the announcement. They make the announcement they're going to cut by half a point as a positive surprise. And then he talks. So he gets up and he talks and, you know, and talks to the press and stuff. And that's where you get, The initial response was, we're going to cut rates by a full point in 2025, and we're going to cut rates by another quarter point sometime in 2026. Well, first of all, whatever. I don't care. It's like, no, that's they can't tell me what's going to rain on
July 5th, 2026. Well, I don't know about that. The weather patterns could change.
100%. Yeah, it's like, yeah, you're right. It's like calling the weather in Cincinnati. I mean, it's like you can't. You know, you don't have a clue what you're going to be doing. You know, you've been telling me for 2.5 years that we're going to go into a recession. Well, guess what? Knock on wood. Still haven't seen it. But then, so you get into that kind of, but it's them just trying to explain to the people what it is they're thinking, okay? And you play the, so it's interesting that when they made the announcement that they dropped a half a point, the market jumped up over 1%. And then it spent the last hour of the day from 3 to 4 o'clock working its way down, and it actually finished down like 0.2% or whatever.
Right.
And then the next day it went up big, right? So, you know, it was taken as a positive thing. Now, the problem is, interest rates isn't the only thing we have to worry about, right? It's you know, now we have, what's going on in the Middle East and things like that. So there's this big concern, especially this one of the bigger concerns today. And we're down over 1% today in the markets. But they're concerned that this whole Mideast thing is going to just spill over into all these other countries, and it's going to become a much bigger thing than that. Also, we have the dock workers and things like that.
Right.
They're striking or are about to strike. You know,
that was the news that, you know, perked my ears up in the most recent days, is when they start saying, okay, the dock workers strike and how it's going to impact our cost of goods.
Yeah.
Basically.
Supply and demand.
All right.
What's the definition of inflation? Definition of inflation is too many dollars chasing too few goods. So now, theoretically, or depending on how long this lasts, you know, we're taking goods off the shelves, right? I know they made a huge push to get as many goods pushed out of the ports and things like that as they could, but if you're now, your supply is dropping, and we just lowered interest rates by a half a point, so theoretically we're putting money back into the economy. We now have, or in the next few weeks, we'll have more dollars chasing fewer goods. Well, we just spent 2.5 years trying to beat inflation back down, right?
Right.
Well, here we are. You know, it's like, okay, now we got this going on. So that, you know, and that's the thing with investing. There's just all these variables coming at you. And number one, you know, what's the severity of those variables? Number one. Number two, how long are those variables? You know, is this strike going to last 24 hours, or is it going to last a month and a half? I mean, you know, that's the question.
Well, that's
right?
What I was just going to ask you.
Yeah.
You don't know the answer to that?
No, I wish I knew. we'll add that to the things I wish I knew. But you know, we have spent whatever it is, 2.5-3 years, trying to get the supply chain back to something that resembles normal. It is way better today than it was 2 years ago. It's still not normal. Okay? And that's coupled with the fact that you have what's going on in the Red Sea, you have a drought that's, you know, going on with the Panama and Panama Canal. What else am I forgetting? Red Sea, the Baltimore Bridge collapse.
Right.
And now you're talking about a strike. Okay. So these are all those things impact the flow of goods.
Not to mention transportation issues resulting from the recent storms.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, we won't even get into that, but I mean, you know, like you said, Baltimore Bridge collapse. Well, then throw in, you know, highways and byways that just got shut down because of hurricane damage. You know, smaller scale, but bridge collapses that change transportation routes and have an impact on distribution of goods.
Yeah, 100%. And while we're at it, let's throw an election year in on there, too. So, you know.
Well, you know, and throwing this out, this is kind of early in the campaign. When we get to the end of this show, we're going to say it specifically. But, so, Taking Stock, episode 35 right now, today, as we recorded. And our next one is going to be, because we're not going to be back in 2 weeks.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
So barring doing an extra, which we could, we might do an episode next week. We'll check in with each other and see if it warrants, you know, some special conversation. Sure. But aside from that, the next episode following that, even if we do one next week, is going to be the Tuesday before Election Day.
Is that right? Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that should be a good one.
Yeah.
You can make all kinds of predictions.
Be the 29th of October or something like that.
Yeah. Well, if it goes as normal, you know, we'll have our third or second Taking Stock episode in November, and maybe we'll get lucky and even have some results. So,
anyway, we both kind of got left speechless there for a second, which isn't good when you're like essentially listening to the radio,
right,
as it were a podcast. But, you know, but as you said, throw into the mix, it's election year. And I just wonder with some of these things, like a dock worker strike, like the, you know, the warring factions in the Middle East, and how big of an impact this U.S. presidential election is having on those events taking place or not happening.
Yeah.
Because, it, you know, the administrations, presidential administrations, you know, in history have helped often in terms of strikes like a dock worker strike and how it impacts you know, consumer goods and the flow of consumer goods and, you know, like you said, the supply chain. So it's, you know, I don't know where it all fits in.
Well, I mean, if you are running for president, I would say it would behoove you to get in there and negotiate or mediate or whatever, arbitrate, whatever words you want to use.
Right, no, right.
A solution to the problem, right? Whether you're the current administration or you're the other person running, it's, you know, it wouldn't hurt you to get in there and try and make it better and make it better fast, right? You know, try and negotiate.
That's my point.
So, yeah.
That question, because it's like, what's the impact? And you know, historically we've seen the presidential administrations step in and make a difference. Mm-hmm. You know, one that comes immediately to mind is, and it was very interesting the way it was handled by Ronald Reagan with the air controllers.
Right.
Air traffic controllers.
Right. Yeah, well.
And that union.
That's, yeah.
You know, we can't have that.
Yeah.
That was a theory.
We can't have that, so stop.
You know, I'm going to have a real quick aside. You know, again, just people want to talk about bullying. That's not bullying. But anyway.
He did it in such a nice way, though.
Sure he did.
He made you feel
unless
good.
You were sitting across from him at the table as a part of Petco. Yeah. You know.
He smiled at you the whole time that
God
he did
bless
it.
Him. Anyway.
But you know,
he just didn't seem mean.
No.
Anyway, we don't want to go down that path too far. I've already taken us off the beaten path. But again, I mean, these are high-impact things right now,
sure.
The supply and demand. And, gosh, you know, predicting, you know, seeing the economic numbers going the right direction and the inflation numbers, which brings us to, you know, you shared with me during this past week some information about, you know, the Fed say inflation rate. Mm-hmm. And am I recalling correctly that was down to 2.2%?
Yes, 2.2. Yeah, is that their favorite indicator, the personal consumption expenditure
right.
indicator.
PCE.
Yeah, that actually, they were looking for 2.3, and it actually came in at 2.2. So, you know, I will admit that at the beginning of this year, I said it was going to be pretty difficult for them to get down to that 2% number. Well, here we sit 3 months before the end of the year, and they're knocking on that 2% door. So, yeah, it won't be the last time I'm wrong.
You're okay. We're not going to revisit all those numbers until December.
Oh, we are going to revisit them, though.
Don't you think?
Yes, I think we should. But,
yeah.
No, it would be a definite.
You may not want to, but you think we should.
You know what? If I was that good.
But, here, you know, so here's the thing. I mean, it's still, we climbed all the way close to 10% inflation.
That's right.
You know, it's good to see the inflation rate dropping. One of the things that was encouraging to me, and I'll ask you this question, because you've said, you know, if we see the prices dropping, that's a bad thing. You know, unless something bad happens, you're not going to see. Well, they're talking about we're seeing prices drop a little bit. There's a move towards some lowering of prices in certain areas, not because of a bad thing.
No, and it doesn't. I mean, to see a completely broad-based, all prices are kind of like how we saw all prices go up, to see it drop, generally, something not so great has to be happening in the economy. But that doesn't mean there aren't other areas. I mean, let's say eggs. Eggs just shot through the roof, right?
Right.
Well, they have back down some. So there are other market forces going on in there, and that could be productivity, that could be automation, that could be increased supply. You know, it could be a whole lot of things that causes that to happen on an individual basis. So, you know, it doesn't have to be something terrible going on for, you know, some things here and there. I mean, obviously gas prices just bounce around all over the place, you know, but
the number impacted by that, is it right for me to say that's the consumer price index number, the CPI that ultimately is impacted by that?
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, and honestly.
So how's that looking today?
We're that's got a 2 in front of it also. What is that, 2.8 or something like that? 2.7 on the consumer price index, yeah.
So you're telling me, you're not asking me.
Yeah, it's below 3. Yeah. Okay,
right.
So
right.
As I've mentioned multiple times, I like 3. So, you know, so anything below 3 for me is icing on the cake, okay?
I'm with you.
Yeah, so, you know, 10 is bad. Let's be clear. 10's bad. I don't care who you are or why you're looking at it. 10's a bad number, 10% inflation. But, and that's the thing. You know, again, we always kind of try and take a look at things from a long, you know, there's, and I had this conversation with someone this morning. There will always be something to worry about. Always. There's always going to be something going on in the world, something, you know, and as I like to say, it's usually the thing that you don't see coming that really causes the most trouble. And, you know, the dock worker thing, you could see it coming, but it's not exactly like we've been talking about this for months, right?
Right.
It's kind of a new thing. Okay, what's this become? And then the other side of that equation is, you know, we went through this whole thing, same thing with, like, United Auto Workers. Well, that they were on strike for well over a month. Mm-hmm. If I can't remember exactly how long it was. But, you know, they walked away with 25% increase in pay. Okay, well, guess what? That 25% just doesn't magically appear. Okay, so that means you're going to have to increase
prices
somewhere. And it's the same thing with the dock workers. I don't know what they want. I don't know what they're asking for. But let's say they walk away with 25% increase in pay over the next 3 years. Guess what? The cost of transporting goods and things like that just went up, which means it's going to have to get passed along somewhere. So once again, here we spent 2.5 years trying to beat down inflation, and here's another area where something is coming from somewhere else and working against us and trying to accomplish that. But at least we're coming at it from a standpoint of 2.2% inflation not 9%.
We would not want to be starting at that. We're sitting at 8% inflation rate and then looking at an increase.
Yeah.
So, 2.2%. But the problem is, you know, I just want to see the hamburger get back to
$8. Yeah, well. How about if I say don't hold your breath? Well, here's the thing. So, like, something ice. I don't buy ice, right? But I bought a big bag of ice.
Yeah,
it's $6 for a big bag of ice. I'm like, they rang it up $6. You know, here's a little window into my life. But they have $6, and I automatically I was like, oh, that's not right. Well, guess what? It was right on $5.99 for bag of frozen water.
I'm sorry, sir. Could you check that price?
That's right.
I don't think that's right.
In my head, I'm like,
and he looked at me and said, I don't think it's right either, but it's correct.
That's right. He says, well, you can get 2 bags for $11. And I'm like,
what a deal.
I don't need 2 big bags of ice. But it's just another.
I have an ice secret for you when we're off off the air, so I can't tell that to everybody. Just closest personal friends.
Well, yeah, with our thousands of listeners, you know, we don't want to give that secret away. So,
they'll all show up at a certain door.
That's right.
Not mine, by the way.
It's not yours.
The secret isn't ice at Chuck's house. Yeah. Just so you know. Well, hey, we're coming to the close of our episode number 35. It sounds to me like what people should be keeping an eye on is the dock worker strike.
Yeah.
And the Middle East.
That'd be a good place to start.
And the impact that those things could have ultimately on our global economy and certainly our own local economies as well. Anything else you want to tell us for sure? Good news, bad news?
How about if I leave us with a little positivity?
I love that. That's what I was hoping
for. There you go. That's right. We dig down deep for a little positivity here. So the interesting thing is from a historical standpoint, if you go back into history, the 12 months following the first rate decrease, the next 12 months, on average, the market goes up 18% over the next 12 months. So we had our first rate decrease 2 weeks ago, right? So theoretically, somewhere, some are better and others are worse, right? Somewhere, the average is the market goes up 18% over the next 12 months. So I'll take that. If we do 10% over the next 12 months, I'll be a happy camper. So.
I was supposed to ask you a question. I got a question from somebody.
Uh-oh. Good.
And I wrote this question down to make sure that I would ask you and get a chance to talk about it. And now I'm going to blame my wife.
Okay.
Because I wrote it down and I set the paper down. Uh-huh. It's really my fault, but I'm still going to... She keeps a very clean house.
Oh, that's good.
So I had it written down and placed somewhere, so that way I won't forget it. And have it down here in our studio for this. However, she cleaned up. And so I didn't see it. Yeah. And it just occurred to me, I don't know where that question is. And I don't remember the question. It had to do with range. What if I said range bound? Does that mean anything to you?
Range, there's a couple ways of looking at that. But, for the last...
We are range bound.
Well, we are range bound, but actually we're not anymore. We actually have been hitting new highs here over the last couple of weeks. Now, nothing like, oh my gosh, this is fantastic, but we have been hitting new highs on the index, on the indices. So yeah, we were range bound, honestly, for a couple, 3 months.
I see.
Yeah, we really were. I mean, we did a lot of bouncing around. But we still kind of stayed within this sandwich of a range or whatever. With the rate decrease that we got, that actually finally pushed us up through the top of that range, and we're actually hitting. So we're now in the 5700s on the S&P 500.
I saw that.
Yeah. So if that's the range bound that you're speaking of, that would
absolutely. I'm trying to conjure up that question as it was, and that was the discussion, and said, well, ask Art about the marketplace being range bound. So we'll have some more conversation about that in the next episode of Taking Stock.
And remember, we talked about that a little bit.
Absolutely.
Like, there wasn't, like, I get my comment, I think, was there's not really a great reason for at that time. Wasn't a great reason for us to go up 10%, but there really wasn't a great reason for us to go down 10% either. We were, the economy, everything was looking good, but the interest rates and the interest rates and the corporate earnings numbers really weren't enough to kind of really propel you up into new highs. Well, now we've got some lower interest rates. We've still got the corporate earnings, so now it moved us up to a higher level.
Right. So. Excellent. Well, Art, thank you so much.
No, thank you, sir. As always, enjoy it immensely.
Well, and I'm going to say, as always, there were lessons learned.
Oh, good.
Today. Even if some of them were like Pete Rose stuff.
I'm not sure how the rest of the world feels, but that's a big deal in Cincinnati.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. So we don't mind talking about Pete and his baseball career here.
Yeah.
The lesson learned is, the thinking about if you want as part of your investment portfolio collectibles, that's the lesson. Just remember what collectibles are, and they're a whole lot different than other economic things. But anyway, so as always, lessons learned today in Taking Stock, episode 35, as we bring it to a close and look forward to potentially some talk next week. But if not, we're going to be 1 week away from the presidential election day when we meet again.
And we should have all kinds of stats for that discussion. So, yeah.
Well, until then, thank you again, Art Jarvis. Appreciate it.
All right, thanks, Chuck. Take care.
Thanks for joining us for this edition of Taking Stock with Art Jarvis. Join us again in 2 weeks for our next edition. Taking Stock with Art Jarvis is a presentation of Loveland Beacon in partnership with Jarvis Global Investments, LLC. Jarvis Global Investments, LLC is a registered investment advisory firm. The advisor is not attempting to furnish personalized investment advice or services during this production. Individuals should fully investigate the appropriateness of any investment before investing. Past performance is no guarantee of future results. Investments may lose value.